102,000 people that came forward to get tested in the last 24 hours. That is a new record. And to have us pass that 100,000 mark on a weekend in a 24-hour period is outstanding. So thank you so much to everybody who came forward and got tested. New South Wales recorded 141 cases of community transmission in that 24-hour period, and 38 of those were infectious in the community. I wanted to also extend my condolences to two families who are grieving today. We had two deaths overnight. A woman in her 70s, but also a woman in her 30s with no pre-existing conditions. So if anybody thinks this is a disease just affecting older people, please think again. Again, I want to extend my heartfelt condolences to those families, their loved ones who are grieving today. But please note that younger people without pre-existing conditions can also fall victim to this cruel disease. I wanted to stress a couple of points this morning. Firstly, please know that what will get us through this outbreak is a combination of our restrictions, but also of more people being vaccinated. So can I urge everybody to come forward and vaccinate it? As you know, the health advice has changed in the last few days, so everybody is welcome to come forward and get the AstraZeneca vaccine. And please know that whether it's through your GP, through a local pharmacist, or through obviously our New South Wales health hubs, please come forward and get vaccinated. We know that in particular, older people are more vulnerable to this disease, and we're hoping already that more people come forward to get the vaccine, but I can't stress enough how important it is to get vaccinated. One thing we also know with this cruel Delta strain, which is what we're dealing with, is that even one dose of the vaccine not only gives you personal protection, but it also reduces your chances of passing the disease on to others. And that's why during the Delta outbreak, higher vaccination rates, even of the first dose, slow the spread down. It won't stop the spread alone, but it will definitely, definitely slow the spread down. Instead of infecting your whole household, you may only affect a few people. Or instead of infecting your entire workplace, you may only infect a few people if you have at least one dose of the vaccine. And that's why it is so important to have that combination of restrictions and also higher vaccination rates. Please know, in those five local government areas in particular that are impacted, we are doing all we can to increase the vaccination rates, including providing vaccines through local pharmacists, through GPs, and through our New South Wales health hubs. So please come forward to get vaccinated for your sake and the sake of those closest to you. That is what will get us through this outbreak, combined with the restrictions that we will put in place or have in place. In relation to yesterday's protest, can I say how absolutely disgusted I was? It broke my heart. Millions and millions of people across our state are doing the right thing, and it just broke my heart that people had such a disregard for their fellow citizens. I just ask everybody to think about that. Each of those people who protested illegally, I'm sure, have loved ones. They're going to go home and risk passing that virus on to their most closest people to them. And I just urge everybody that we are making enormous inroads in other places around the world with similar populations and densities to ours. Case numbers would have been in the thousands and thousands. We've stopped that. And what we need to do now is reduce the number of people infectious in the community. And that is a challenge for all of us and a challenge we take jointly. And I just urge everybody to please do the right thing. Please follow the health advice. I know there are a lot of people out there, a lot of experts out there, legitimate experts and so-called experts. But please know the New South Wales government is relying on the best medical advice we have in our nation and making sure we take decisions to protect all of us. And I personally, on behalf of the government, say we will always make decisions in the best interests of our citizens to keep everybody safe and to get us through this outbreak. So thank you to all of you doing the right thing. And to those of you that aren't, you should be ashamed of yourselves. Dr. McAnulty will now give the health update, and then Deputy Commissioner Warboys will say a few words before we'll take questions. Thank you.
Good morning and thank you, Premier. I'll take you through the numbers of cases from overnight, from yesterday. New South Wales recorded 141 locally acquired cases until 8 o'clock last night. 87 of those locally acquired cases are linked to other cases in the cluster, and 54 remain under investigation. There were no new locally overseas acquired cases in the same period. There have now been 2,081 cases associated with this outbreak since the 16th of June 2021. And a record number of over 102,000 tests were done yesterday. So thanks very much to the community for coming forward to meet this challenge. By isolation status, of the 141 cases, 65 were in isolation throughout their infectious period and 24 for part of their infectious period. 38 were infectious while in the community. Sadly, we've been notified of two deaths overnight, as the Premier has mentioned. A woman in her late 30s died from the Sydney CDB area has died, and a woman in her 70s from southwest Sydney has died. These are very tragic events, and our sympathies go out to their families, friends and loved ones. There are a number of people in hospital. 141 people are in hospital with COVID at present, and 43 are in intensive care, 18 of whom require ventilation. So this is a very serious disease. Of those 141, 60 are under the age of 55 and 28 under the age of 35. And of the 43 people in intensive care, one is in their teens, seven are in their 20s, three are in their 30s, 14 are in their 50s, and 12 are in their 60s, and six are in their 70s. So this is affecting people of all ages with very serious disease. All but one are vaccinated. One person has just received one dose of vaccine. By LGA, most of the cases are in five LGAs. Fairfield with 34, Canterbury-Bankstown with 30, Cumberland with 24, Blacktown with 19, and Liverpool with 12 cases. So we're still seeing concentration of cases in various LGAs, but cases elsewhere in the Greater Sydney area. So anybody in the Greater Sydney area is at particular risk, but we're seeing cases in these particular LGAs. We're particularly concerned for people in certain suburbs to come forward for testing with even the mildest of symptoms. And I'll just go through those areas. On the north coast of New South Wales, Coffs Harbour and Byron Bay, we've seen positive sewerage in recent days in Byron Bay. In southern New South Wales, Moss Vale, again, we've seen positive sewerage without a known case there. Also, Goulburn and Marulan, we're keen for people to be aware for symptoms and come forward for testing. In western New South Wales, Orange. In western Sydney, Cumberland, LGA, Merrylands and Guildford in particular, Toongabie, Pendle Hill, Mount Druitt, Rutty Hill, Blacktown. In northern Sydney, Belrose, where we've had transmission. In the inner west, Lakemba, Roselands, Punchbowl, Wylie Park, Belmore, Burwood, Campsie, particularly Tong Lee Supermarket, Growers Market, and T&L Butchers, where we've had transmission. In southwest Sydney, of course, the Fairfield LGA, particularly Old Guildford, Liverpool LGA, particularly Hoxton Park, Carnes Hill, Voyager Point, Canterbury-Bankstown, Sefton, Yuguna, Chester Hill, and in Campbelltown, particularly Bardia. In southeast Sydney, we're still worried about Georges River, Bayside, Sutherland, Waverley, and Haymarket, and in Illawarra, Wollongong, and Port Kembla. If you're in any of those areas, please come forward for testing with even the mildest of symptoms. It's just so important. We're concerned about a particular gathering I mentioned yesterday in Pendle Hill. This is a grieving family who came together to support each other. We know at least 50 people were at that gathering, and we've now got 28 cases associated with that gathering. So we've been working with community leaders in that area to make sure that people in that gathering are isolated and getting tested. It's so important to come forward for testing, but it's a measure of just how dangerous it is to come together from different families. Don't visit other family, don't visit other household. Don't let anyone from your extended family who doesn't live with you to come into your household. It's so important, even if you think it's just not safe to do so. I've also been notified of a person who's now in Queensland who had been on a flight while knowing that they're a close contact. So the person travelled on the 14th of July to Ballina from Sydney on Virgin Flight VA1139 from Sydney to Ballina, arriving around 11:45. anybody who was on this flight as a close contact must get tested and isolate for 14 days from the date of their exposure, regardless of the result of the test. So the flight manifest we've received, and we're contacting all patients, all passengers directly. So we're aware of the person. He was tested positive on the, he was tested on the 12th of July following identification of a workplace exposure. He was advised he was a close contact and to isolate for 14 days regardless of the test result. We understand he got a test result which was mistakenly provided by a private lab to inform him he was negative, but this didn't change the fact that he had to isolate for 14 days. On the 20th of July, we were advised that the swab was in fact positive, and following a whole genome sequencing test, the case was immediately contacted and interviewed further that day. He stated that he had been isolating since the 10th of July. However, we know this is not true. We were believed he travelled to Queensland on July 14 and concerned about the nature and extent of his exposures on the flight and in the community, both in New South Wales and Queensland. So we're working with our colleagues in Queensland Health, and we referred the matter to the New South Wales Police. I'll leave it there. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Thank you, Dr. McNulty. Premier, 510 penalty infringement notices issued in the last 24 hours. The vast majority of those two people whose behaviour yesterday in and around Sydney could only be described as violent, filthy behaviour, risky behaviour that police will continue to investigate. A strike force is set up right at this moment that continues to ask for people to bring forward any video files or telephone footage that they have of that sort of behaviour that was clearly not the community's spoken. The community has said it's, they will not tolerate it. And we ask people to upload those files, to upload any information that they have to Crime Stoppers, 1-800-333-000. And the investigation into people's behaviour yesterday will continue for some time. So I expect over the next few days and perhaps weeks that that number of penalty infringement notices will continue to be high. What I would also like to say today is that yesterday police were welcomed much better behaviour in and around distancing and exercising on the beaches right from north down to south of Bondi. It was much welcomed by police and indeed local council and everyone in and around there to be able to exercise in a much less risky fashion. We want people to continue that. We want people to make good decisions, and we want people to respect the public health orders. And each and every person needs to understand that they have a part to play in where we head over the next days and weeks. The other thing that I wanted to call out today was we still have people, in particular in that Eastern Beaches area, that want to try and sell alcohol to people that are exercising or going out of their home to pretend to exercise and then consume alcohol. There are very strict guidelines in terms of alcohol-free zones, particularly in the Waverley Council area. Alcohol is prohibited on the beach and in parks around the beach. People need to understand that this is not a time to make money on the back of the public health orders and this state trying to get through the pandemic as best they can. What we would ask is clearly for those places that that have a licence, that they don't breach and infringe, but most importantly, that they look at the spirit of the actual orders, and what they are doing is simply encouraging people to break the public health orders. We want that to stop, and police will continue to do business inspections. They will continue to work with Crime Stopper reports around businesses that want to draw people out of their houses to sell cocktails, to sell alcohol in plastic cups without lids, which is clearly designed to be consumed on the street. Thank you.
Deputy Commissioner, while I've got you there, obviously one of the photos that galvanised this was the punching of the horse. What did you make of that, firstly, but also how many police officers were assaulted yesterday?
Yeah, well, fortunately, police come out of that confrontation well. Obviously, there were scratches and bruises. Obviously, police were highly confronted, but they never took a backward step. Clearly, the behaviour was absolutely disgusting. It will not be tolerated, not just by the police, but by the community. It's been overwhelming, the support to police, and in particular, you reference the police horse. Look, you know, that person has been charged with animal cruelty offences, with affray and various other offences. Again, overwhelmingly, there is not a person that supports that sort of dreadful behaviour. But what I will say is that at 1 o'clock, the Police Minister and Deputy Lenyon will stand up and they will have far more information to provide you.
Did the size of the protest take police by surprise? Did it swell much quicker than you expected it to?
No, look, not at all. I'm here as the CEOCON today, but I'm well aware that the police executive and indeed all of the intelligence around that, we've been working on that for weeks now, well over 2 weeks that I can recall. So no, I don't think it took the police by surprise at all.
Premier, in relation to the protest, Premier, there are fears that it could be a super spreading event with so many people coming all together, but we won't know that for a while. Just the fact that it happened, will that extend the lockdown that we are currently in?
I think that's why all of us were absolutely disgusted and disappointed yesterday, because we know that events like that can cause those super spreading events. And please know that all of the sacrifices we've made over the last 3 or 4 weeks in particular have resulted in us being able to stabilise the growth in cases. We don't want a setback, and yesterday could have been a setback. Time will tell. But I'm just so utterly disgusted, disappointed and heartbroken that people don't consider the safety and well-being of their fellow citizens. Each of those people who illegally protested, I'm sure, have significant loved ones. How would they feel if they went home in their day-to-day life and gave the disease to their loved ones? And as we've seen tragically overnight, this strain of Delta is not discriminating on age, on circumstance, on where you live. This is a horribly cruel disease, and that's why our response has been so strong against it. But we rely on people not only to do the right thing, but not to openly threaten the health and safety of the broader community. I hope it won't be a setback, but it could be. As Dr. McAnulty said, unfortunately, a bereaving family with a number of people coming to support them during bereavement has seen 28 cases from that one incident. Please know that we're doing remarkably well across the state in keeping the virus at bay, but it only takes a couple of incidents to cause these setbacks. I don't want to burden our citizens any more than we need to, but we also rely on each other to do the right thing. And can I say the vast majority of people have been overwhelmingly positive. To have more than 102,000 tests in the last 24 hours says to us people are not only listening, but doing the right thing. And we know from the telephone calls we're getting through Service New South Wales that the vast majority of inquiries are around people not wanting to do the wrong thing. So the vast majority of our citizens are doing so well. But when all of us see the images we saw yesterday, we are just left shaking our heads and feeling so disgusted and let down. And I just ask everybody, don't let down yourself and your family. You might not care about the rest of us, but don't let down your family, your closest to you, because this disease doesn't discriminate. And how would you feel if, because of your irresponsible and destructive actions, you gave the disease to your loved ones and they suffered and even died as a result?
Premier, can I just get your thoughts on something? And apologies, this is a longer question, so bear with me. We've had Atagi change the advice on AstraZeneca for people over the 18 years of age. And you said yourself just a moment ago that even one dose reduces transmissibility.
Yeah.
So they are lower risk people in the community who are vaccinated. We really need to come forward for people to get vaccinated. And you said yourself many times in press conferences that that's our way out of this lockdown. Is it time to exempt vaccinated people from lockdowns, considering that that would also drive everyone into vaccination clinics to get vaccinated very quickly because they want that freedom as well.
Yeah, can I say that in relation to providing additional easing of restrictions or freedoms for vaccinated people, we can only consider that when a larger proportion of the population is vaccinated. Because we don't have those high rates of vaccination, that would still be too great a threat on everybody else who hasn't been vaccinated. And not everybody yet has had the opportunity to be offered the vaccine, and that health advice has now recently changed.
Premier, even with countries that have high vaccination rates, the Delta variant is spreading through those countries. So is it time to just start accepting?
The short answer is no, because we don't have those high rates of vaccination. We can't consider those policy decisions until we have high rates of vaccination. Because the point is that we need to firstly keep people out of hospital, which the vaccines do, and we also need to reduce the likelihood of spread, which even one dose of the vaccine does. So the vaccine not only keeps people out of hospital and keeps them alive, but it also reduces the chances of them spreading it on to more people. And that's why it is so key that alongside the restrictions we have, we need to increase the vaccination. And that gives us more options in the future. But can I just say, in relation to dealing with the immediate outbreak, we need a combination of the restrictions, and hopefully in the future the restrictions will change. But in addition to the restrictions, we also need high rates of vaccination, and that's why now I'm urging, given the recent health advice has changed from the Commonwealth, that everybody should come forward and get vaccinated. But especially, we know, those older are more vulnerable because their immune systems are weaker. So those older are more vulnerable. But what we're seeing now is the disease is indiscriminate. And if you haven't had the vaccine, you can succumb, even if you don't have any other underlying health conditions.
Right.